Hello students, in today's session we will discuss how to design a compression member. In compression member, few terminologies are required which we have seen in previous session. In the previous session, we have understood that what is slenderness ratio, what is effective length, how the compression members get filled, what are the different modes of failure, and with that knowledge, we will today try to understand how to design a strut. Strut is a part of or element of trusses. In the trusses, you have many short elements or members connected to form a complete long span truss, right? And those short members may carry a tension or compression. The members which is shorter in length and carries the compression of a trusses are called it as a strut. And in today's session, we will discuss how to design a strut member. Now, let's start with the few of the clauses from IS code. First, I am taking axially loaded columns for rolled steel sections. Now, axially loaded columns or any members, basically, whenever I say compression member design, the compression member is a member in which the compression is applied axially through that member. The compression is applied axially through that member. And whenever you are designing such a member, it mostly fall into category of columns. So even if I'm saying I'm gonna design a truss, I'm gonna design a strut member, it somehow falls in a category of compression member or column. All right. So let's keep aside that title and focus more on the content, what I said here in the paragraph. Okay. So, as the buckling strength of a column is affected by residual stress, initial woe, and accidental eccentricity of a load, then if such a things happens inside a column. Column is made out of course, different sections. I section, channel section, or composite section. You can use two more sections and combine it to form a column. All right. If you are looking into that column, then that column is consist of its own classification. That column is consist of its own classification. Or I can say a compression member on the basis of buckling are classified as following. What we are discussing here is classification of compression members on the basis of buckling. Now, in the previous tension members, we have gone through section classification, in which I have discussed what is slender section, what is plastic section, and many others. Those are the classification of sections that remain same in a compression member also. What I am discussing right now, what type of classification it is? A buckling classification. A buckling classification. You should remember it. Now, let's read the paragraph here. As the buckling strength of column is affected by residual stress, residual stresses are the stresses which remained while casting or which developed while casting of any section. If you are casting I section, angle section, channel section in the rolling procedure, hot roll procedure, or cold roll procedure, in that procedure what happens? Some stresses remains inside your object or inside your section. Those stresses are called as a residual stress. Then initial bow and accidental eccentricity. Okay, so some defects caused manually or due to machine errors, there are some stresses and is accidental eccentricity means what? If you are supposed to apply load at its center, but it's got shifted from its center, then we called it as due to some accidental cause or due to some manual error that shifted from its original. Then all these things causes a buckling, okay, and that affects the buckling So, IS code 800, IS code 800-2000 define buckling classes. They have defined a buckling classes that in which category and what type of buckling it is. Okay, so you have a table for it in your IS code. We will discuss it deeply afterward. See here. Depending on the infection factor. So what's the basis to classify these sections? How do you classify these sections? The sections are classified on the basis of what? On the basis of imperfection factor. And they are classified in how many categories? 1, A, B, C and D. In 4 categories. You have table of this. These categories which were enlisted. That table is mentioned in IS code 800. 2000 on page number, the table number is 10 and it is mentioned in IS 800 and page number is 44. Okay, so open your IS code and go to that page number. I required it for further explanation. Now, next is factor design compression load or factor design load. Okay, whenever I'm saying I'm designing a section, that designing of a section is for particular amount of load, right? I'm designing against that particular amount of load. And if I'm saying that much load is coming across my section, I have to give a strength more than that. I have to select a section which has a strength more than the external loading, right? So it is... While designing compression member, you should remember that your design strength, PD, P suffix D, your design strength should be greater than your compressive loading coming across that section. Alright, how to calculate design loading? That will be design suffix, its symbol is P suffix D, and how to calculate that? That will be given by this formula P suffix D equals to AE, A suffix E into FCD, into FCD. Alright, so what this terminology is, AE and FCD is called for. Okay, so this is called, AE is the effective sectional area and FCD is a design compression stress. A is the effective sectional area, whichever section you have used or whichever section you have selected from the steel table, the effective area of that section. And FCD is a design compression stress. Now, how to calculate design compression stress? That is a question, right? How to calculate that? That I'm going to make you understand in coming few slides. All right. Now, the design compressive stress FCD of axially loaded compression member is given by a table number this of your IS code. Again, this FCD is mentioned in your IS code in a table. The names are mentioned here. Those are the naming of it. Now, let's see what this buckling classification is and how those table utilized for our designing purpose. So see, if I am using I section, then this I section has classified into 4 categories. Buckling category A, B, C and D. A, B, C and D. Here you have a classification further. Now, to understand that classification or which section, which buckling class, which section belongs to which buckling class, you must understand the limits. You must understand the limits. What those limits tell to us? The limits are saying us that if H by BF ratio, what is this H by BF ratio? This H stands for height of your I section. And B stands for BF, B suffix F stands for width of flange. Take a ratio of it. If it is greater than 1.2, if it is greater than 1.2, and if further requirement is if TF is what? Thickness of flange. If the thickness of flange is lesser than 40 mm, if this condition satisfied, then go for at which axis, about which axis buckling is taking place. If it is taking at ZZ axis or YY axis, you should check here. This is the ZZ axis, this is the YY axis. If it is buckling at ZZ or YY axis, then accordingly you will come to know which buckling class it belongs to, which buckling class it belongs to. Understood? This is how you do for I section. I section has another condition over here. If H by BF ratio falls greater than 1.5, sorry, H by BF ratio falls less than 1.5, less than equals to 1.2. In that case, in this case, you have second block over here. Check at what axis the buckling is taking place and then check the buckling class. Alright, this is how you should do for other sections. This is for other sections. This first I section is for rolled I section. Second one is for welded I section. After that, we will do for hollow section. For hollow section, whichever it may be, hollow circular, hollow rectangular, hollow square, or whichever it may be made out of hot rolled or cold rolled, any of it will belongs to A and B category respectively. Okay. Similarly, I am using angle section. Mostly in the strut design, we will use an angle section. So let's see for angle section, which buckling classes. For angle section, buckling classes, any angle section if you choose. Any angle section if you choose, the buckling class will be C. You should remember it that any angle section, if you choose for designing of a strut, the buckling class for it will be C. Alright. Now, in the first page, we understood that the design compressive strength should be greater than the loading coming upon it. Okay, we understood that PD is equals to AE into FCD. Then we understood how to check the buckling classes. How to check buckling classes. Understood? Now, coming to the next, here we will try to understand design procedure and formulas required for single angle strut member design. Okay, so what they said, if a single angle is loaded in compression through one leg and it is subjected to flexural torsional buckling, in such a case, the design strength PD may be evaluated using the non-dimensional equivalent slenderness ratio lambda E. This lambda E term is very important, and the formula for it is mentioned over here. See, I am saying the strut member is the short member which carries the compression and majorly found in the trusses. Understood? Now we want to design it. We will choose an angle section for strut. If I am using an angle section, if it is carrying a compression, and what if instead of compression it also come across a bending or flexural torsional buckling? This is the fourth mode of failure. I have discussed mode of failures with you in a previous section where I discussed fourth mode of failure is a torsional buckling or flexural torsional buckling. If it is comes across flexural torsional buckling, subjected matlab it come across or it suffered or it experience, in such a case the design strength PD, which is PD is equals to how much? A effective area into FCD. That may be evaluated using non-dimensional equivalent slenderness slenderness ratio lambda e, and it is given by this formula. Okay, now whatever formula here after I will discuss, that will be given over here. You should not mug up those formulas, because these all formulas are available in your IS code. These all formulas, first, second, third, whatever formulas you can see here, these all formulas are available in your IS code. I will tell you the step. These formulas are available on page which I have added in this. Yes, here you can see lambda e. It is mentioned in your IS code, clause number 7.5.1.2 on page number 40. Now, as I said, these formulas are mentioned in your IS code. That page I have added over here. This formulas which you can see over here is added into this IS code, and it is mentioned on page number 48. Okay, so let's go to that page only. Yes, we have that page with us. So I have a screenshot with me which giving us lambda e formula. Let's understand these terminologies and where we get that terminologies. Okay, so this k1, k2, k3 are the constants depending upon the end conditions. Constants depending upon the end conditions. Okay, what do you mean by end conditions? End conditions in the trusses of that strut member can be a pin. Okay, all the truss members, especially a tie and strut members in the trusses are pin joint. Okay, so that's the end condition. How they fixed at their supports or at the joints, that's what we called as a end condition. So here K1, K2, K3 will be a constant, depends on the end conditions, and those are mentioned in table number 12. Table number 12 is mentioned in your IS code. Go to the table number 12. We required it while solving the problem. Okay, then other terminologies from this formula, lambda VV and lambda phi. These are mentioned over here. And to understand its terminology, L is the center to center length of the supporting member. Center to center length of the supporting member. Then you will understand better while I'm giving you an example. I will solve one example for you, and from there you can get it. Okay. Now second is the RVV. It's a radius of gyration about minor axis, and where from you will get that? You need a steel table for it. You need a steel table for it. From the steel table, you can calculate what is RVV. You need not to calculate even. It is mentioned for every I section in your steel table. Select from it. Okay. Then B1, B2, that is width of the two legs of the angle. B1, B2 are the width of the two legs of angle. Okay, if I am using angle section, B1, B2 will represent the width of that angle section. Then T will be thickness of leg. Of course, the angle section has the thickness, that will represent it by T. And Epsilon will be a yield stress. Epsilon will be a yield stress ratio. Okay, and that is given by 250 divided by Fy under root. This suffix 0.5, nothing but under root. Okay. Now, this table number 12 is mentioned over here. Okay, from there you can calculate K1, K2, K3. Only you need to know that what end conditions are there. Okay. Coming to the next, determine. Now we will try to solve one problem. Here in this problem, the question reads, determine design compressive strength of an IS 125 into 95 into 10. Okay, it is not visible. You must write it down in your notebook. I am solving this strut with the angle which I am choosing is 125, or which mentioned in a question is 125 into 95 into 10. Okay, first leg is of 125, second leg is 95, and 10 is the thickness of leg. This is the unequal length angle. Okay, and weight of it for per meter is 16.5 kg. Per meter it weighs 16.5 kg, in which longer leg connected to the gusset plate of thickness 10 mm by 3 number of M20 black bolts of 4.6 grades. Okay, now whenever you have to do a designing, you should know few of the terminologies. And one terminology, this is a university question actually, and one terminology in this university question is missing, and that's why we need to assume that, and that assumption will be length. Okay, the length is not mentioned in your IS code, and that's why it is not mentioned in, sorry, it is not mentioned in your question. Okay, it is not mentioned somewhere in your question, but we required it to solve it. We required it to solve it. Okay, therefore we will assume it. This is a university question, and they missed, somehow they missed to mention what length they are using. So that's why I have assumed it 2.5 meter. Don't worry of this assumption, because definitely whenever question will ask of this type, they will definitely give you a length. Okay, now using clause number 7.5.3, okay, that is the clause which we learned in the previous part of this session. Okay, just before we understood this clause. Okay, and all the formulas are with us in the IS code, just finding step by step all the constants and slenderness ratio. Okay, so we will try to find first lambda VB, then lambda phi. Okay, lambda VB and lambda phi. So lambda VB is given with this formula. Put the all values. The length was not given, that's why I have assumed it as a 2.5 meter. Okay, length is 2500, which is in mm. RVB is 20.2. actually it is 2.02 mentioned in your IS code. Not in IS code, in steel table. Okay, it is mentioned in your steel table, and it is 2.02. okay, but the unit is centimeter, so from centimeter I have converted it into mm. I have converted it into mm. Okay, now this length is in mm, the RVB, radius of gyration along VB, is 20.2. you can check it, this RVB, in your steel table for IS section 125 into 95 into 10. I hope you getting it. Okay, now pi is a constant. E for steel is 2 into 10 to the power 5. It's a constant for steel. Young's modulus for steel and 250. Solid, you will get 1.39 as an answer. You will get 1.39 as an answer. Okay. Now, next is lambda phi. Next is lambda phi. This formula is also mentioned in your IS code. B1 and B2 will be a leg of your angle. So, leg of our angle is 125 and 95. So, leg of angle is 125 plus 95 divided by 2t. Thickness was 10. Divide by epsilon in bracket pi square e into 250. Okay, now what is epsilon? Epsilon is mentioned over here. It is under root 250 by Fy. If you calculate it, you will come across the answer as a 1. You will come across the answer as 1. Now, using table number 12 of IS 800-2007, this table number 12 is mentioned in your IS code, that you required to calculate constant K1, K2, K3 of this formula. And these constants are depends on what? End conditions. These constants are depends on what? End conditions. And if these constants are depends on end condition, you need to take care of or you need to understand what end conditions we are solving for. So here the end condition wasn't given, you can assume it. The assumption was both ends are hand, as the strut, as I said, strut is a part of your trusses and trusses carries a pin jointed members in it. Therefore, I am taking this end condition as hinged. And from table number 12, this table number 12 is with me. Yes, that is above actually. Yes, we have here. This is the table number 12. Now this table number 12 is consist of this two first column, which says that number of bolts at each end connection. Number of bolts. Kitne number of bolts se wo connect hua hai. So in the question they have mentioned that there is a 3 M20 black bolts, right? So it is greater than 2, therefore, and the our assumption is hinged end. So I have selected this K1, K2, K3 for our calculation. Okay. Yes, here. Alright, you understood how to do or how to find K1, K2, K3. Now, once we calculate K1, K2, K3 and other slenderness ratios, you come to know that lambda E is 1.39. Lambda E is 1.39. Now, what this further part is? What this further part is? How we calculated PD? PD is AG into FCD. How we calculated that? For that, I have a, this all formulas are in your IS code. You need not worry how to calculate this, how to mug up or how to learn these formulas. Don't worry, those are with IS code. So see here, this next term where it is mentioned over here, design compressive strength PD of a member is given by PD is equals to AE into FCD, right? And how to calculate FCD? That is also given for, yes, here. It is design compressive stress obtained as per IS this clause. What this clause says? That clause says the design compressive stress FCD of axially loaded compressive member shall be calculated using following equations. What that equation is? That equation is FCD equals to this formula. That formula is consist of 5. That formula is consist of 5, and that's why we need to understand what phi is. The phi is also given here with the formulae. And you must be wondering that why there are so many formulas and how we derived it, who derived it, okay? In the Ramamrutam book, you go a reference book, you will get to know how these formulas are developed. It is a mathematical, whenever you calculate PD, this PD, design strength, this PD is evaluated by one partial differential equation of second order. Okay, you will get to know. If you want, let me know. I will discuss that topic separately with you. But here, the derivation of formula is never asked. What you want or what you're supposed to do is to understand these formulas and apply it to solve the problems. So, this is FCD and this is phi and this is the lambda. Okay. So this all things we mentioned in your IS code, we will take help of it and here we will try to solve it. Okay. So lambda E, which we calculated, is 1.39. That will be this lambda, and phi is mentioned in the IS code. Solve it for that formula. Phi will be 1.75. Okay. Now FCD. FCD is also has one formula. Put all the values in the formula of FCD. FCD is what? Design compressive stress. Okay. That is formula required for it is in your IS code. Put all the required values mentioned above and solid with your calcium. And we come to know that FCD will be 80.78 Newton per mm square. Therefore, PD is the design strength. Design strength will be equal to AG into FCD. AG into FCD. Now, what is this AG is? It's a gross cross-sectional area. Or you must be thinking that, ma'am, you said PD is equals to effective area into FCD. Don't worry. It is the same only. The effective area is a gross cross-sectional area of your angle. And that is mentioned in steel table. Select that and calculate what is PD. Understood? This is how we have designed a strut member. This is the simplest problem in compression member design. This is the simplest problem in the compression member design. All right. Many of the clauses are required. Please remember all these pages of IS code. These are very necessary. Yes, one point is need to understand, which I forgot. Yes, this imperfection factor alpha, where do we need it? We need it here in the calculation of 5. Okay, can you see here? We have an alpha in this 5. This alpha is mentioned over here. Yes, this says alpha is an imperfection factor given in table number 7. Okay, so you need that for calculation. You can take it from this table number 7. You can take it from table number 7. Okay, but now you must be wondering, ma'am, which class? Buckling class. Which class we should be take? So, if you remember, all the angle sections. Yes, you must be wondering that if we want to calculate alpha, we should understand which buckling category our section belongs to. And to know the buckling class, you should know that our angle section falls for C buckling class. How do I say that? Because our table mentioned here. Yes. This table says if you are choosing angle, then it will belong to which buckling class? C. So you should take help of this, all the tables, IS clauses, formulas mentioned in the IS code, and you should try and practice this kind of many other problems in your notebook. Thank you so much.